Please stand and let us together sing Change Our Hearts.
Celebration in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
May the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
God has invited us to this house of prayer to offer and to receive the gift of the Eucharist. Let us place our hearts before God's peace and ask for forgiveness and mercy. Jesus, you are the faithful one. Christ Jesus, you are the merciful one. Lord Jesus, you are the hopeful one. And the church sings,
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Have mercy on us.
Let us pray. O God, you are the author of every mercy and of all goodness, who in fasting, prayer, and almsgiving have shown us a remedy for sins. Look graciously upon this confession of our lowliness, that we, who are bowed down by our conscience, may always be lifted up by your mercy. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated as we gather the children together for the Liturgy of the Word. Wow, we got a whole bunch, don't we? This is my grandniece here. She's visiting with her mom and dad. Well, we hope that you have a good time breaking open the Word and finding out what Jesus is telling us today. The candle leads the way. There you go.
We abide an awesome mystery. In your death we are reborn. Though you die in all of history, still you rise with every morn. Still you rise with
Our first reading comes from the book of Exodus. It's just one of several scriptural versions of the Ten Commandments. The ancient Aramaic word that we translate here as commandment can also be translated as instruction. It begins with God's self-description as the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. This situates the commandments or instructions in a context of liberation from bondage. In other words, rather than being restrictions on the people, the commandments, the instructions, are descriptions of how to create a holy, consistent life in a community that God has called together into freedom. The commandments are not so much a set of objective rules as guidelines for relationships. Let's listen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of their parents, to the third and fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord. You shall not do any work, you, your son, your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, but rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Is from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians.
Most people in Paul's world were divided into Jews and Greeks. Today we might think of Catholics and non-Catholics. That's one way of depicting us and them. And then there's nobody else. But in this passage, Paul says the old categories of us and them do no more than describe people who don't understand what life is about. Jews, the religious in-crowd of the moment, demanded signs, be they portents or miracles, anything that would prove that God is on the side of the speaker, on their side. Greeks, the sophisticates, looked for the sublime, the wisdom that satisfies the intellect, a good equation that will explain life. Paul writes off both groups as unable to grasp what has been revealed to those whom God has called. The God Paul has come to know and love through Christ doesn't coerce belief through incontrovertible signs, nor entice the intellect through irrefutable logic. The only guarantees Paul offers are God's call to believers and God's love expressed in Jesus' self-gift and self-giving. To some, that may not seem like much, but Paul is convinced that it offers more insight than human wisdom and far more power than human strength. Let's listen.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. The message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For Jews demand signs and Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified. A stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. The word of God.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle and sheep and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" And Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." They then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you're going to raise it up in 3 days?" But Jesus was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. When he was in Jerusalem during the Passover festival, many believed in his name because they saw the signs that he was doing. But Jesus, on his part, would not entrust himself to them, because he knew all the people and needed no one to testify about anyone. For he himself knew what was in everyone. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Temple for the Jews was a center of economic and political life. But more, it was the dwelling place of God on earth. For the Jews, the temple was a place where heaven and earth met. Where the Garden of Eden is finally restored. But corruption has entered into the temple being built by human hands. It's also been compromised. This is John's version of the cleansing of the temple. Jesus is acting as Messiah, the Savior of the people, cleansing the temple of these corruptions. Saul of Tarsus, Paul, who wrote our second reading, studied many years in Jerusalem and knew the rituals of the temple. He begins his letter, the first letter to the Corinthians, by saying, "Make your bodies a sacrifice, a living sacrifice." Sacrifices were meant to accomplish unity between humanity and the divinity. It was the smoke of the offering that rose to God in a way we could not. Now, many scholars think that our gospel reading today, written by John, about the cleansing of the temple, was written after 72 AD, which was when the Romans destroyed Jerusalem and destroyed completely the temple within it. And so as we listen to the gospel, that temple didn't exist anymore. It was rubble. And so for John, we are the temple. We are the meeting of heaven and earth. It's no longer in the temple of Jerusalem. It is in the very bodies of the followers of Jesus that this holiness exists. In his letter to the Romans, Paul says, make your bodies a living sacrifice. Sacrifices were meant to establish unity between heaven and earth, between us and those we have trouble with. Every aspect of yourself, your life, is to be the sacrifice turned toward God, turned and dedicated, a sweet offering, a sacrifice unto the Lord. Mind and will, heart and body, sexuality, family life, friendships, entertainment, everything in you is to be a living sacrifice to the Lord for others, not just yourself. Jesus, as he goes about the temple with his whip, enters into you. If the word Lent means spring, it becomes spring cleaning. Lots of stuff needs to get tossed out or rearranged. There's one thing a lot of us have done during this pandemic. With all this time on our hands, we've cleaned house. If we let Jesus in, everything in us that is not of God needs to be reformed, to be turned over. Going back to our first reading, the 10 instructions that Thomas Aquinas calls moral imperatives, planted deep within our souls, it's worthwhile to look at them one by one. First, the first commandment, the most basic sin is idolatry, turning to something less than God into God. Duty, honor, power, country, celebrity, success, money, our own ego. What are these things except idols? Can you say the Lord is the center of your life? As they say, show me the proof. Second commandment, speech about God. How we speak shapes how we think, not just the other way around. Speech doesn't just come from thought. Speech shapes thought. Once you say something out loud, it takes on a new weight in our minds. How do we talk about God? Is it casual, disrespectful, blasphemous? Three, keeping the Sabbath holy. And this is a powerful command for today. The human race has had a sense of a supreme being. But today is the first time in all of human history that a significant portion of humanity no longer worships God. In the 2020 U.S. census. Over 60% of the people living in a half-mile radius of here said they no longer had affiliation to any church. 4. Honor father and mother. Family integrity. How is your family life? Do you and your family honor God together? How are things going with your family is a key moral concern. 5. Thou shalt not kill. Not many of us go around killing people, but if you are a life, are you a life giver or a life taker? Does your attitude, your outlook on life, raise people up? Or does your constant complaining drain them of life? Thou shalt not kill. 6. Thou shalt not commit adultery, of particular relevance today. Popular culture has become very interested in sex that is not manipulative, not abusive, not self-regarding. These are the very things the church has always taught. Pornography, the beating or abuse of women, the sexual abuse of children, the coarsening of sex in general, the pandemic of domestic violence that has erupted this past year. 7. Thou shalt not steal. Certainly relevant in our economic life, but also in our personal life. St. Thomas Aquinas said that gossiping amounts to stealing someone's reputation. Let that one sink in. 8. Don't bear false witness against your neighbor. Oh, how we love to drag our neighbor down. And if we can't say true things, we'll say false things. Could any of us go even one day without dragging somebody's reputation down? Let that sink into your heart. You know, as you watch TV or watch our politics. Let Jesus with his whip turn that one over in our lives. The last two commandments can be taken together. Thou shalt not covet your neighbor's wife. Thou shalt not covet your neighbor's goods. Coveting, that's desiring. Looking at what the other person has and wanting it. A popular psychologist says today, don't compare yourselves to others. That always leads to a dead end. Stop worrying about what they have. Compare yourself to what you were yesterday. In other words, are you making progress in becoming the person you want to be? Stop fussing about other people. Work on yourself. So when you get home today, why don't you take out your Bible, open it up to the second book, Exodus, and allow Jesus to overturn the corruptions of your life. Take them one by one. You got the time. What is Jesus telling you this Lent? Amen.
Please rise.
I believe in one God, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, the Son of our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Please listen now, all gracious God, to those who have gathered here to become a people of love, of compassion, of light.
Please join in a sung response at the end. For the church, for those who long for a community but who are without a church home, and for all those who come to the community to find God's presence in their lives. For the leaders of the world, both of church and state, may they truly strive for peace, knowing how deeply we all long for the end of war, strife, and hate. And for the safety of our military, Red Cross, Peace Corps volunteers, and all those dedicated to peace. For those who do essential work without adequate compensation, for the hungry, the homeless, the jobless, and the working poor who do not have sufficient means to provide for their basic needs. Every time we gather for prayer, we pray for ourselves and for others. We remember the sick among us, that those who have died and all who grieve, washed clean of their sins, may enter the heavenly city. At this Mass, we remember Richard and Carl Karch. May perpetual light shine upon them. Let the church sing.
All-knowing God, may these prayers offered be a sign of our willingness to have a changed heart as a result of being drawn closer to you. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated.
Not a stone, but a
pray then, sisters and brothers all, that these our gifts may be acceptable to God, our Heavenly Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at our hands
for the praise, the glory of God's name, for our good, the good of all His holy church. Be pleased, O Lord, with these sacrificial offerings, and grant that we who beseech pardon for our own sins may take care to forgive our neighbor through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just. It is our duty and our salvation always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you have given your children a sacred time for the renewing and purifying of our hearts, that freed from the disordered affections, we may so deal with the things of this world as to hold rather to the things that eternally endure. And so with all the angels and saints, we praise you as without end we acclaim. Almighty Father, we bless you through Jesus Christ, your Son, who comes in your name. He is the word that brings salvation. He is a hand that you extend to sinners. He is a way by which your peace is offered to us. When we had turned away from you on account of our sins, you brought us back to be reconciled, Lord, so that converted at last to you, we might love one another through your Son, whom for our sake you handed over to death. And now, celebrating the reconciliation that Christ brought us, we entreat you, sanctify these gifts by the outpouring of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, whose command we fulfill when we celebrate these mysteries. For when about to give his life to set us free, as he reclined at supper, he himself took the bread, he said the blessing, he broke the bread, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body given up for you." In a similar way, that very same evening, he took the chalice of blessing in his hands. Confessing your mercy, he gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant. It will be poured out for you and for the many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, save us, Savior of the world, by your cross and resurrection, you have set us
there's a word here that appears in this Eucharistic prayer and several of the Eucharistic prayers, the word memorial. I, growing up, had a real hard time with that because I thought a memorial was like a statue or a plaque on a wall to remind us of something in the past. For the Jews, the word memorial meant that you brought the past into the present. Like that Passover meal was a memorial, it brought their past into the present. It truly was an entering in to the saving Red Sea. It was an entering in to becoming God's people. And so, celebrating, therefore, the memorial of the death and resurrection of your Son, who left us this pledge of his love, we offer you what you have bestowed upon us, the sacrifice of perfect reconciliation. Holy Father, we humbly beseech you to accept us also together with your Son, and in this saving banquet graciously endow us with his very Spirit, who takes away everything that estranges us from one another. May he make of us, your church, a sign of unity and an instrument of your peace among all people. As we celebrate our Pope's pilgrimage through the countries of the birthplace of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, may he make your church a sign of unity and an instrument of your peace. And may he keep us in communion with Francis, our Pope, Jerome, our Bishop, all the bishops, your entire people. Just as you have gathered us now at this table of your Son, so bring us together with the glorious Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with your blessed apostles, with all the saints, with our brothers and sisters and those of every race and tongue who have died in your friendship. Bring us to share with them the unending banquet of unity in a new heaven and a new earth where the fullness of your peace will shine forth. In Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
So, at our Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, peace I leave you, it's my own peace that I give you. Look not upon our sins as we stand here before you, but look upon the faith of your church gathered here and throughout the world. And graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
We share with one another Christ's peace. Carefully. Peace be with you. Behold the Lamb of God, behold the one who takes away the sin of the world. Happy are we, for he invites us to share in his everlasting banquet. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Accepting death upon
Good evening, Good Shepherd. Join us this Sunday at 11 a.m. on a Zoom for our In the Spotlight presentation. Our very own Mike Crane will present Just Offer It Up, The Spiritual Value of Sacrifice. The link to the Zoom can be found on the website on the Adult Formation tab or in your parish emails. Yum! Fair trade chocolate, coffee, and olive oil. I vote for the chocolate. Our fair trade sale will continue through March 15th. Pick up an adult form on the table in the narthex or see the bulletin or website Adult Formation tab for more information. Middle and high schoolers, tomorrow is your last chance to register for the Wisconsin Catholic Youth Rally. So see the app or website for the registration. We will be offering several choices of Mass times at both Good Shepherd and St. James for Easter. We are asking that you register so we can keep everyone distanced. Please see the parish app or website to make your reservation soon to save your spot. If you do not have access to the internet, you may call Karina in the Christian Formation office to make your reservation. Finally, yes, we still need help sanitizing the church after Mass. Please see the ushers, Mike Marking or Joel Slasky. Your help is greatly appreciated.
Let us pray. As we receive the pledge of things yet hidden in heaven and are nourished while still on earth with the bread that comes from on high, we humbly entreat you, O Lord, that what is being brought about in us in mystery may come to true completion through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. Oops. I gotta know the blessing. Direct, O Lord, we pray, the hearts of your faithful. And in your kindness, grant your service this grace that abiding in the love of you and neighbor, we may fulfill the whole of your commands through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our celebration here is ended. Let us go forth to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Broken, where's the body?